I hope that by kind of drawing a rough sketch of what philosophers do, we can maybe get a better sense of the pursuit of it, being more than the thing that just, you know, a speech and debate kid would do, and doing more than a person who's trying to soul search would do. All right. So here are some of the branches of philosophy, and these are no way all of them, in no way all of them. But I'd like to just present you with some of the main ones. So the first one I have here is metaphysics, and this has to do with the concept of reality. And so oftentimes we'll be asking, you know, what's the ultimate reality? What exists? What does not exist? These kinds of things. And if any one of the branches is the abstract one, you know, the one we think of being really far out and asking really big things, it would be this one. It's been going on forever, and it's been most point to, you know, have an origin with the pre-Socratic philosophers in ancient Greece. And as we speak right now, I'm sure there's a PhD student trying to write a paper about it, and trying to get it into a database. And then the next one would be the field of logic. And this one I think we hear a lot, but I don't think we know about all the things that are going on in the field. Jump into it one way, and I think the first way would be that it's correct reasoning. So this can be in everyday life. This can be how a state tries to talk to other states. You know, we're seeing that right now. And most would say that logic is important for this, and I would say it is as well. But just keep in mind that there are philosophers working in this branch as we speak, and it's expansive, and it's way more than correct reasoning, and there's all kinds of technical terms that, you know, you'd have to spend hours and hours researching to know of. The third branch is ethics and politics, and I have this grouped under one kind of heading here, because they're kind of under a big branch that is called value theory. And I'm not going to go into that because, again, you know, hours and hours of trying to talk about it. And so ethics is the study of ideal conduct. And so oftentimes, you know, we say, is this the good or bad things? We often associate this with morality. But as I said with the previous branch, this is so much more than that. A person who are working with ethics is working with many different fields, or can work with many different fields, from science and bioethics to military ethics, which is a thing we're seeing right now as we speak, and we've seen in history, of course, and also business ethics, you know? And so, and ethics will pull on many different branches, and so I'll go into that later. Politics is the next one, and it is the study of ideal social organization. This is one we've seen, you know, today in the talks, and this is one we see all the time. And just like, I mean, it's really expansive, and just like the previous fields, it's been going back years and years, and most, again, say it goes back to the ancient Greek philosophers. And one example of that was in Plato's Republic, where he asks, you know, kind of, what's the ideal state, right? And so that's an example of what's the ideal social organization. The final branch I have here is the philosophy of science. And the principal task of the philosophy of science is to analyze the methods of inquiry used in science. And so philosophy of science can get down to this very precise kind of area in science. And so I think we see a lot of different sciences pulling on this field. And it's this view that there's a bit of a divide between philosophy and science. And, you know, this kind of appears every once in a while. We'll see, like, a physicist saying that philosophy is obsolete now. And I think if we're going to, you know, it's a big debate, and I don't want to get into it because it's so expansive, again, just like everything else. But I think if there's any bridge between the two, which I think there's way more than just this branch, but if there's any one main branch between the two, I'd say it's the philosophy of science. And so keep in mind now that I've given you a kind of brief overview, really, really brief overview of what philosophers do. And here's some other branches. All right, so now I've give a big spiel about what philosophers might do. So now I'm going to move on to kind of the main theme of this talk, and that is the attitude of philosophy. And I'm trying to kind of bring in everything I just spoke of to kind of one main idea. And I brought this idea up in my mind as the attitude of philosophy. So what is this attitude? Well, I believe it's the, I don't know if I believe it, but that'd be a tricky statement to make, but I think it might be that philosophy is always taking a step back. And so, and this often we might call questioning or critical thinking. And so I have an example here. So in Plato's book, Republic, Simicus says, justice is the advantage of the stronger. And the main character in this book, which is Socrates, asks, are you sure about that? And basically, they never get to a conclusion of what justice really is, but they continue taking a step back. They continue asking and asking, what might this be? What might this be? How might this work in a state? All these different kinds of things, and I believe this might be the attitude of philosophy, of taking a step back. And I think we've done it right now. We've been doing it all throughout these talks. For example, I might say, I believe, for example, I said, I believe that the attitude of philosophy is taking a step back. Well, you in turn, you in the audience, can take a step back on me, and then in turn, question me by what I mean by this. And I think that's philosophy in action, taking a step back. And so now I want to center this idea of taking a step back, of continually questioning things, by relating this to stories. And remember, I said you can take a step back on what I've said. You can do this throughout the whole talk. There might be a thing an idea that I proposed that you don't particularly think you think is strong, and so you can then take a step back. So keep this in mind. This is another abstract idea that worked up in my mind that I think is cool. You can take a step back on it and ask if it's valid or not. You can ask all kinds of things about it. So please do that. Please keep that in your mind. You can take a step back on this speech and really everything I'm saying. All right. So could we view the world as world stories? And this is kind of where I want to tie this attitude in and kind of answer the so what, who cares part of this. If we agree that philosophy, its main theme is to take a step back, then you might ask, well, so what, who cares? If that's great, then why should I pursue it? And so I kind of hope to answer it through this. So could we view the world as stories? I already brought these up. Well, how about through these songs we listen to? We have Adele there, we have Nas, we have all kinds of music we listen to. Are there stories behind the music? Do the artists themselves have a story? Do they produce a story through their song? And in turn, do they promote a story in us? For example, you might be a young kid from where Nas was from, and you might think, I really love his songs, and I want to create my own songs in my own way, but pull on what he did. And so you might become the next great rap artist, and that might be your story. So does that promote a story? And is there stories? I think we could say maybe there are stories in music. How about in film? Film's a big one. Even from the most well-known filmmakers, such as Stanley Kubrick, to kids' shows, to the Avengers. Again, you can ask the same thing. Are there stories behind the films? Do the films then promote stories and their plots and so on? And then does that inspire another, maybe kid, to think, oh, well, I'd love to make a film like that? And are the films themselves, do they inspire social movements, for example? I think we've seen this, and I think we've also seen films being a product of social movements. You guys have heard of. How about in books and various forms of art? We have Dante up there, we have Jean-Michel Basquiat, we have Homer. We have all these stories that maybe we consider part of our culture. Maybe we present, we say that they are part of a certain era. They've inspired certain artists, certain social organization. Yeah, again, James Joyce, Ulysses, mass fiction as well. It can be the highbrow, whatever that is, of course, the highbrow or the lowbrow. It can be, I think, anything. And how about in history? This is one you see in history class all the time. Is history a story, and all the stories within history, does it inspire a future story? Do we in the U.S. view our story in a particular way or a particular set of ways? And do the people in the U.S. View that a future story might occur or should occur? And how do people view the U.S. story outside of the U.S.? How does that vary? Right? And so we have all kinds of this. We also have important figures in history as well. Does Malcolm X have a particular story? When we think of that Malcolm X, are we thinking of a particular story with all its different aspects, all its different variations. Again, more important historical figures. And in science, too. I've Einstein up here and Richard Feynman as well. Does science have its own story? When we're learning about the cell, and maybe we're learning about the history of the cell, the history of us learning about it, is that a story? And is there a story to the developments of ideas such as the theory of relativity. And again, I have important historical events, religion as well. Of course, the Bible is a set of stories. But again, same thing with music, same thing with film. Does this promote stories? Does this inspire stories? And what stories are they made of? And philosophy itself, I have the big beard man, Friedrich Nietzsche himself here. He wrote his philosophy and stories, but what's his story? And what stories has he inspired in the development of philosophy? And a big one, how about states? Again, it's the U.S. has a certain story. I have a country here called Bolivia, and this is where kind of half of it is from, and there's kind of a story I associate with this place as my heritage and so on. Is there a story I have with it? Is there a story that people who haven't been there have? And does it promote a story within me? Is there something I want to do that relates to Bolivia? And how about the alliances between these places? Is there a story ongoing there? And how does this tie into history? How does this tie into film? How does this tie into culture? And of course, the conflicts between states. And this is one that's going on right now, of course. Is there a story there? Is there a way we view that story as being in a year or so? And how does that vary between where you're from? And is there a story behind why this is occurring? And then there's us, you know, just mere people on streets. Is there a story behind us? Is there a story that we have of ourselves? Is there a way we'd like to see ourselves in a few years, or a month, or in a week, if you're like me, and I'd like to see some change very quickly? Now, I mentioned earlier the attitude of philosophy is to take a step back. And given all these pictures, we've kind of seen stories layered on top of each other. And so this is exactly where I think taking a step back unifies all of this, right? And again, remember I said that philosophy can pull on so many different fields, from science to history to social sciences to artists to all these different fields. And then it has this kind of maybe a central attitude of taking a step back. And I would say that philosophy could be the foundational way of inquiry, the foundational way of sorting through these layers and layers and cakes of stories that we have in our lives. And so I'd like to illustrate this through a thought experiment. And so there's this planet, it has 7 billion people on it, they call it Earth. This might sound like a thing you know about. They send these people into space on an expedition. And these people are in space, you know, doing their thing, and they encounter a planet that seems just like Earth. And they're like, oh my gosh, you know, is this Earth? And no, it's not. It's actually maybe version 2 of Earth. It seems like it's exactly like Earth. And so they arrive on this planet, and unfortunately, they crash. But now they're here, and you know, sick man, Einstein. I think that's how Einstein would like to be portrayed, of course. So they arrive on this planet, and they're like, oh my gosh, this is exactly like Earth. It's a carbon copy of Earth, right? And then they see people, and they're like, are these huge? There's no way these are humans just like us, and indeed they are. And what's interesting about this, and the Einsteins realize this, they're like, these humans seem to be humans just like us, but they seem to be stuck in a period that's about a few thousand years away from us. So it seems like we've gone back in time and encountered ourselves from a previous state of the development. And so these are kind of what we might call the primitive era time of Homo sapiens. So the question I pose to you, and to the Einsteins and the human there, is this. What happens to the Einsteins? What do the Einsteins do now that they've kind of seen these humans, a way that seemed to be in a time way before them, not they don't have, you know, cars and this and that, and the Einsteins also have all this history, you know, they're thinking, you know, all this history that these humans might do what we did, exactly what we did, and end up how we are in a thousand years. And so what do the Einsteins do, right? And what happens to the Einsteins, and what do these early humans do? The early human is kind of encountering like an advanced version of themselves. So what does the early human do? And basically the main question is what happens to both parties? And I think, even though it's a bit of abstract kind of thing to ask, I think you'll find yourself doing the three things I mentioned. I think you'll find yourself viewing the world as stories. You might be looking back on history. You might be pulling on science. You might be pulling on ethics, thinking what should happen in this thing. You might be pulling on your knowledge of states, and you might say, oh, I know what the Einsteins would do. They should form the next U.S. on this planet. It should be great. So you might be thinking that. So you'll be pulling on a world of stories, I would say, maybe. And then you'll also be taking a step back, asking yourself, is this the right thing to do? Is this a logical way to go about this? And you might also be asking, is this aligned with the philosophy of science? You might be taking a step back and pulling on these different fields, pulling on history, pulling on your own story, maybe. So you'll be taking a step back, you'll be viewing the world of stories, and you'll be pulling everything together. Those are kind of three main things I want you to keep in mind. And that is my talk, and I hope that maybe I've inspired you to read some of these books and, you know, engage in what we might call philosophical inquiry. So thank you.